زادك الأيام فتا وتنحي.
The mandub, last lesson, and we were in al-mubah, which is aqsamu al-hukm al-taklifi. So we're in mubah. We spoke about last lesson, the ways that the mubah comes in the sharia. How we know that something is mubah. We said, وَنَثْبُتُ الْإِبَاحَةُ بِسِيَغٍ كَثِيرَةٍ وَرَدَتْ فِي النُّصُوصِ الشَّرْعِيَّةِ وَمِنْهَا. The first one was, نَفْيُ الْإِثْمِ وَالْجُنَاحِ وَالْحَرَجِ. That Allah, He removes ithm, sin, burden, and from the people. Now we gave evidences from the Qur'an. The second way we said that this something can be known that it's mubah is, a text comes and it says it's halal. And we gave the example of the ayah, أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةَ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ إِلَى نِسَائِكُمْ. أُحِلَّ, made halal. The third one, we said it was that a text is not present to say that it's haram. There's no present text that says it's haram. So we leave it at its original form, which is that everything is permissible until proven it's haram. And we said that this is meant by al-mu'amalat. As for ibadat, we said, فَعَدَمُ الدَّلِيلِ دَلِيلٌ عَلَى بِدْعِيَةِ وَتَحْرِيمِ. And we brought the call of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, where he said, انْتِفَاءُ الدَّلِيلِ تَحْرِيمِ دَلِيلٌ عَلَى عَدْمِ التَّحْرِيمِ. Which basically is, الْأَصْلُ فِي الْأَشْيَاءِ النَّافِعَةِ الْحِلْ. Which is that qa'ida. That every single thing is permissible, every beneficial thing is permissible until a text comes and says it is not. And that's, of course, transactions and more, you know, not ibadah. Ibadah needs evidence to do it. Then what we said was, the first two that were mentioned, the first two, which is nafyu al-ithmi wal-junahi wal-haraj, and the an-nassu al-hil, the first two, we said those are called ibaha shar'iyya. The third type that was mentioned, we said it's called ibaha asliyya. And we spoke about that last lesson. We spoke about that. And we gave the evidence for the third one, which is, وَهُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. Allah created everything on the face of this earth for you all. It's allowed, permissible. As long as there comes no text and says it's haram. Today we're going to go to the fourth way to find out if something is mubah. الامتنان بما في الأعيان من المنافع وما يتعلق بها من الأفعال كقوله تعالى ومن أوصافها وأوبارها وأشعارها أثاثا ومتاعا إلى حين. Number four, الامتنان. Allah mentions a blessing in which He has bestowed the people in a particular matter which they are allowed to benefit from. Allah says, I have brought this for you, I have bestowed this for you, I've given you this for you to benefit and use it. So this is to show that it's mubah. You're allowed to use it. Because Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will not say, I did this for you, and show that He blessed us with something unless it's what? Unless it's mubah. If it's haram, then there's no need for Allah to tell us that He blessed us with it. No.
Is it under asliya?
No. We've mentioned it. It's types to know how they are. That's it. It's the ways that they come in the texts. Okay. Number five. Is al-qara'inu allati tasrifu al-amra min al-wujubi ila al-ibahati. Okay. The fifth one is, in the text, and this we don't want to go into much details because inshallah, it will come to us when we come to the chapter of al-amr, order. Which is, a text comes, and then in that text there's a command. And that command gets diverted from its obligation, which the command generally, what does it indicate? A command that comes in the Kitab and the Sunnah generally indicates that it's obligatory, it's mandatory. But unless there comes a text and diverts it from that original essence, correct? This is called a qarina, that thing that turns it away from its original essence, which is that we have to do this thing, is called what?
Qarina.
A qarina. This qareena makes it what? It takes it away to ibaha sometimes. Sometimes. And this is one of the ways to know that something is mubah. I'll give you an example, and with the example it becomes clear. If you go to Suratul Ma'idah, if you go to Suratul Ma'idah ayah 2, Allah says, وَإِذَا حَلَلْتُمْ فَاصْطَادُوا. When you وَإِذَا حَلَلْتُمْ This ayah says, وَإِذَا حَلَلْتُمْ When you finish Hajj, and you become halal. Because in Hajj, what were you? Muhrim. You were in a state of ihram. If you go to a state of halal, where you get out of ihram, and you leave the Hajj, huh? What did Allah say? فَاصْطَادُوا Go and hunt. Is it obligatory to hunt? Does one have to go on a hunt? Even though it's a command. Now the ulama, they say, huh? They say, al-amru, an order that comes بعد الحذر, after a prohibition. If a command comes, that command prior to it was what? Before it was what? A prohibition. That command will not show obligation. It will show that what the thing, that which the thing was before it was prohibited. It will go back to its original form. That which it was before it was prohibited. Are you all with me? For example, take this verse as an example. Allah tells us what? وَإِذَا حَلَلْتُمْ فَاصْطَادُوا Hunting at its original essence was what? Mubah. Mubah. It got prohibited, right? Are you all with me? Did it get prohibited? Yes, in a state of ihram, are you allowed to hunt? You're not allowed to hunt. Allah prohibited us not to hunt whilst we're in a state of ihram. Are you all with me? Then you got ordered to go and hunt. This order goes back to its original essence of what it used to be before it got prohibited. What was it before it got prohibited? Mubah. This is called a qarina. القرينة التي تصرف الأمر من الوجوب إلى الإباحة كقوله تعالى such as وإذا حللتم فاصطادوا These are ways to find out that something is مباح. So the one that we mentioned before, this one is called الامتنان بما في الأعيان من المنافع وما يتعلق بها من الأفعال. To say that something is what? To say Allah says I blessed you with this. You guys can benefit from it. وما يتعلق بها من الأفعال. From those evidence for that one is what? The evidence for that is the qawl of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the fourth one I missed, which is the verse of Allah in Surah Al-Nahl, ayah 80. Allah says, وَمِنْ أَصْوَافِهَا Aswaf is wool. وَأُبَارِهَا is fur. وَأَشْعَارِهَا is hair. أَثَاثًا using it as furnitures. وَمَتَاعًا as and things. إِلَى حِينٍ for a very short time. Allah said, so the word the wool comes from the goat, the fur comes from the camel, and the ash'ar comes from the lamb. Allah is saying, I bestow these ones on you so you can benefit from them. It's mubah for you. That's what Allah is saying, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fifth one I said is, Al-qara'in التي تصرف الأمر من الوجوب إلى الإباحة كقوله تعالى A diverter diverts this command from obligation and it diverts it to إباحة. Such as the second verse in Surah Al-Ma'idah, وَإِذَا حَلَلْتُمْ فَاسْتَادُوا This will come to us in more details, inshallah, in this book, when we come to the chapter of Al-Amr, commands. So we're not going to dwell too much into it. وَيُطْلَقُ عَلَى الْمُبَاحِ لَفْظُ الْحَلَالِ The word mubah is used sometimes as the word halal. Halal takes the sometimes. So there are synonyms of each other. Halal. Even that though, the word halal is more general. The word halal is what? أَعَمُّ Why? لأنه يطلق على الأربعة because it's used for the four. واجب is halal, mandub is halal, makruh is halal, and even mubah is halal. So four of them are halal. So halal is slightly more comprehensive, more general. The question that now arises, brothers, is why is mubah in ahkam al-taklifiyah? We took at the beginning when we were talking about ahkam al-taklifi, you all remember ahkam al-taklifi when we were speaking about it. What did we say ahkam al-taklifi? What do we say ahkam al-taklifi is? Ilzamu ma fihi mukulfa, right? We said anything that is in it burdening. That's linguistically. We said shara'an, it means what? Talabu ma fihi mashaqa. It is to be requested of something that has a burdening in it. You see? How does mubah enter that? Because mubah, we know, there's no kulfa in it. ما وجه إدخال المباح في الأحكام التكليفية مع أنه لا كلفة فيه when there's no kulfa, burden or hardship in it فالجواب إن شاء الله three answers The first answer is ma qalahu jumhur al-usuliyin, what the majority of the usuliyin said. What the majority of the usuliyin said, which is min anna idqal al-mubah fi al-ahkam at-taklifiyyah innama huwa ala sabil at-taghlib. The usuliyin, they said the reason why mubah was put under ahkam at-taklifi is what? Are you with me? Is from the angle of taghlib. Taghlib means under generalization, from the angle of generalizing something under something. Like the same way, وهذا استعمال مألوف ومعروف في لغة العربي العربية. That is something that this chapter of which is سبيل التغليب. It's something that's very common amongst the Arabic language. We'll see the example for it, inshallah. وأساليبها. In the usage and in the words of the Arabs, they use that type of thing. Such as, for example, they say الأسوداني, the two blacks. When in reality, the only one that's black is what? The date. The water isn't black. Even though they call the water and the date, Arabs, they call it al-aswadani, the two blacks. Which one is black? The date is. But then what happened? They put the water under it. This is called babu taghlib. The second one is example is al-abawad, the two fathers. It's not two fathers. It's anab, your mother and your father. It's like umaran, the two umars. Abu Bakr and Umar, that's what they mean. When Abu Bakr is, what is why I call two umaran? That is called sabilu taghlib. Arabs do use that. It's common. And that's why the majority of the, are you with me? The majority of the fuqaha, usuleen, they said that's why mubah went enter it. From that angle, sabilu taghlib. That's how he entered it. That's the qawl of the jumhur. That's the first view. The second view is the qawl Shaykh ibn al-Uthaymeen said in his usul, min ilm al-usul, and I feel like it's one of the best answers, if not the best. He said, no, mubah has taklif in it. And he said that taklif, because taklif, he said, talabu is to be requested of something that has a burden in it, right? Shaykh ibn al-Uthaymeen said it does have in it. You have to believe that this mubah is a legislation from Allah. And that's requested from you. The belief is requested from you. And if you choose to not believe it, that it's Allah permitted it, you can become a kafir because of it. So the i'tiqad, the belief, he said, is a mashaqah. It's a talab, sorry. Is it not? It's a talab, which you have to come with. So the Shaykh rahimahullah said, it does. Here rahimahullah said what? It is mubah from there. That's the second explanation. The third explanation is, that the usage of the word taklif itself is a question. Who used this word? وهذا الإشكال مبني على أن أحكام الشرعية كلها تكاليف ومشقة. This first of all, the use of the word تكليف is actually saying that the Quran, the Kitab and the Sunnah are hard and burdens. وهذا فيه نظر, and this is a, there's a look to this. It's not as it should, that's not real, that's not the case. فإن وصف أوامر الله, to ascribe and to describe the orders of Allah تبارك وتعالى ونواهي, and his prohibitions, بِأَنَّا تَكَلِيفٌ, that they are burdens. قَوْلُ الْمُسْتَحْدَثٌ, it's a newly introduced speech, that word, تَكْلِيف. أَوَّلُ مَنْ اسْتَعْمَلَهُ, the first person to ever use it, or the first people to ever use it, are الْمُعْتَزِلَةُ. The Mu'tazila were the first to use that word, تَكْلِيف. وَلَا يَصِحُ إِطْلَاقُ, and it's not even allowed to generalize the word تَكْلِيف. It's not allowed. عَلَى جَمِيعِ أَحْكَامِ الشَّرْعِيَّةِ, to generalize the usage of the word taklif in all of the sharia of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, you can't use it for everything. فَإِنَّ كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْفُرُوضِ وَالْوَاجِبَاتِ فَضْلَ عَنِ الْمُبَاحَاتِ لَيْسَ تَكَالِيفُ وَلَا مَشَقَاتِ. Rather, you can find some things that are wajib and that are obligatory, that don't have no taklif in it and no hardship in it, let alone things that are mubah. You see, بَلْ هِيَ رَاحَةٌ وَهِدَايَةٌ وَنُورٌ, rather, it's raha, relaxation. Wa hidayatun, guidance. Wa nurun, and light from Allah. This is how you should describe this. As Allah mentioned in the Quran, Allah calls it raha. Allah calls it hidayah. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala calls it nur. Wa qad wasafa Allah ta'ala ahkam al-shar'iyyati bil yusr. Allah referred to it as what? Yusr. Inna deena yusr. Inna ma'al usri yusr. Allah referred to it as ease. Wa nafa' anha al-haraj. And Allah actually negated from his religion any form of burden. يقول شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية, ابن تيمية said in his مجموعة الفتاوى, ولهذا, and because of that, لم يجئ في الكتاب والسنة وكلام السلف, it has not come in the kitab nor the sunnah, not even the speech of the salaf of this ummah, إطلاق القول على الإيمان والعمل الصالح إنه تكليف. It has not come in the kitab nor the sunnah nor the speech of the salaf to generalize the speech that the iman and righteous actions are takleef, burden. كما يطلق ذلك كثير من المتكلمة والمتفقهة. The same way a lot of people who are ahlul kalam and also the people of who claim to be fuqaha, وإنما جاء ذكر التكليف في موضع النفي. Rather, the usage of the word takleef in the kitab and the sunnah, you find it's used in a form of negation. كقوله تعالى, like Allah said, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah negated it, سبحانه وتعالى. أي وإن وقع في الأمر تكليف فلا يكلف إلا قدر الوسع. And if the takleef does happen in the sharia, then you are only requested to come with that which you're able to do. لا أنه يسمى جميع الشريعة تكليفا. Not that the whole sharia can be called takleef. مع أن غالبها قرة العيون وسرور القلوب ولذات الأرواح وكمال النعيم. Even though the majority of it is that which your eyes will find warmth in it. Your heart will find tranquility and ease, you see. Your soul will find sweetness in. And its completeness of blessings. To call it what? Bad. To call it takleef, all of it. So according to that view, every matter doesn't have to become a burden in order for us to say it's what? For us to say that this is ahkamu taklifi. There are some wajibat that may not even have a mashaqqa hardship in it. Just because a person finds the salah having no hardship in the prayer, can we say that the salah is not ahkamu taklifi anymore? So the issue here right now, that's what Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah went. So those are the three views. Al-mahdur wal-makruh. We're now going to go to the fourth and the fifth. المحذور والمكروه. والمحذور ما يثاب على تركه ويعاقب على فعله. We're now going to go to the fourth one, which is أقسام حكم تكليفي. The fourth one. المحذور والمكروه. What does محذور mean? محذور means, as the مؤلف of the كتاب says, المعلم الجويني إمام الحرمين. والمحذور محذور means ما يثاب, it is the thing that you will be rewarded على تركي by leaving it, ويعاقب, and you will be punished على فعله by doing it. والمكروه, and as for مكروه, ما يثاب, it is the thing that you're going to be rewarded على تركي to leave it, ولا يعاقب, and you're not going to be punished على فعله by doing it. So محذور is the same as the word محرم, it's حرام. And it is haram and mahdura, the same meaning. Okay? What is the word mahdur the Shaykh used? What does it linguistically mean? Ism maf'ul min al-hadari. It's an ism maf'ul and it comes from the word hadri, which means al-man'a, prohibition. Prohibition. Yuqalu yu, they say, hadartu shay idha haramtahu. يُقَالُ, the person says, حَذَرْتُ الشَّيْءِ, I prohib. حَذَرْتُ الشَّيْءِ is when you make something haram, you prohibit it. Or رَاجِعُ إِلَى الْمَنْعِ, and it goes back to prohibition. It goes back to prohibition. Such as Allah said in the Qur'an, وَمِنْهُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, وَمَا كَانَ عَطَاءُ رَبِّكَ مَحْذُورًا. And it isn't that which your Lord gave, مَحْذُورًا, أي مَمْنُوعًا. It is not something that can be prohibited. Again, this definition of the author is تعريف الشيء, defining the thing by what? بإعتبار الرسم. It's defining it by its outcome, its result. It's not really defining it by حقيقته وما هي. The حقيقة and the ما هي of it. The original essence of it. It hasn't defined it. Also, as we mentioned in our previous definitions, the usage would have been better if he said, ما يثاب على تركه امتثالا. Just add to that to it. ويستحق عقاب ويستحق فاعله العقاب ويستحق فاعله العقاب. And the one who does it, he deserves to be punished. And remember, paying attention that not all the prohibitions are the same in terms of rulings.
No.
Some prohibited things, some things that are prohibited are, you are a sinner for doing it. Some you are a major sin doer. You know, what you're doing is a major sin. And some you become a disbeliever because of it. Some things which you're prohibited from, if you do it, you become a disbeliever. Such as shirk, such as abandoning the prayer. They are things if you don't listen to the command, or you don't stay away from that which you're prohibited from, shirk you're prohibited from. You're also prohibited from tarku salah, abandoning the prayer. You become a disbeliever because of it. That is what it means linguistically. Technically, it means ma talaba shar'u tarkuhu talaban jazima. It is what the sharia, the kitab and the sunnah have requested from you to leave it in a forceful manner. From the actions are like uquq al-walidain, the disobedience towards your parents, wa isbalu thiyab, letting your garment below your ankles. From the speech is like what? Also speech. Al-ghibat wa namima. Ghiba and namima. Backbiting, and namima, bringing problems between the brothers, two brothers or two sisters. The last one, which is a'malu al-qulub, actions of the heart that are prohibited for you to come with as well. Which is what? Kal-haqdi wal-hasad. Enmity and jealousy. So when we said, ma talaba al-shar'u, that which the sharia requested you, tarkuhu, to leave it. What left? Tarkuhu. What the sharia requested for you to leave, what leaves that definition? Al-wajib wal-mandub wal-mubah. Because the wajib, the sharia didn't request for you to leave. The mandub, the sharia did not request for you to leave. The mubah, the sharia did not request for you to leave. Then the second part, talaban jaziman, what left? The makruh. Because the makruh is not talab jaziman. So that's how a definition should be. Wal haramu, the haram, brothers, is, which is the mahdur, is diddul halal, is the opposite to halal. The word mahdur and haram are the same. So haram is the opposite to what? Halal. So for example, you say, هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ. For example, you say, this is halal, this is haram. They're opposite to each other. As Allah said in the ayah, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبَ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ. You see? وَلَا تَقُولُوا, do not say, لِمَا. Remember we took that word ma. We took the usage of the word ma. 10. From them was what? Mazdariya. Ma is a mazdariya. So what do you say? You say, وَلَا تَقُولُوا, do not say, لِمَا تَصِفُ. So you say, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِوَصْفِ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ. Because the word is mazdariya. So you say, لِوَصْفِ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ. The describing of your tongues, الكذب, a lie. هذا حلال. You say, this is halal. وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ, and this is haram. لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ. To say about Allah, that which is lies. So, haram and halal are opposite to each other in that same verse. Ayah 116 is Surah An-Nahl. Also, the Usuliyin, sometimes they say haram is the opposite to wajib. They say, al-haramu diddul wajib. Haram is the opposite to wajib. That also isn't a wrong definition. That's also not wrong. Because why? فَإِنَّمَا هُوَ بِاعْتِبَارِ تَقْسِيمِ أَحْكَامِ تَكْلِيفِ فَيُعَرَّفُ الْحَرَامُ بِضُدِّ التَّعْرِيفِ الْوَاجِبِ كَمَا تَقَدَّمْ. The same way, look, if you look at it, they are referring to when it's in أَحْكَامُ تَكْلِيفِ, the way you will define the rasm, the result of the wajib, and the way you define the result of the haram is the same. How do you define the wajib? You define the wajib by saying, مَا يُثَابُ عَلَى فِعْلِهِ امْتِثَالًا. It is that which you will be rewarded doing if you're following it by saying that Allah is command. Isn't that right? Also, وَيَسْتَحِقُّ تَارِكُ الْعِقَابَ. And the one who leaves it deserves to be punished. The opposite to that is what? Haram. Haram is what? مَا يُثَابُ عَلَى تَرْكِي امْتِثَالًا. By, you'll be rewarded if you leave it by following the sharia. وَيَسْتَحِقُّ فَاعِلُهُ الْعِقَابَ. And the one who leaves it, the one that does it, deserves to be punished. So they're opposite to each other. That's what the Usuliyin actually mean by it. When they say that the haram is the opposite to wajib. The ruling of haram is, as Sheikh Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan said in his sharah, He said, وَحُكْمُ الْمُحَرَّمِ The hukm, the ruling of the mahdur, or the haram, is مَا ذَكَرَهُ الْمُؤَلِّفِ Because his definition is the hukm, remember the rulings that comes out of it, is أَنَّ يُثَابُ عَلَى تَرْكِيمُ That the person will be punished by what, brothers? He will be rewarded. He will be rewarded for what? عَلَى تَرْكِيمُ Leaving it. But when? لَكِن بِقَصَّدِ الْمْتِتَالِ With the condition he does it with what? Submission. By saying that Allah legislated it, that I am not allowed to do this action, and I'm going to leave it. He gets rewarded for it then. وَذَلِكَ And that is, بِأَنْ يَكُفَّ For him to leave off, عَنِ الْمُحَرَّمِ امْتِثَالًا That he leaves off the haram by following the kitab and the sunnah in the legislation. قَاسِدًا بِذَلِكَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ And he also is doing it for the sake of who? For the sake of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. فَلَوْ Abdullah al-Fawzan said, فَلَوْ تَرَكَهُ لِنَّحْوِي كَوْفٍ مِّن مَخْلُوقٍ أَوْ حَيَاءٍ أَوْ رِيَاءٍ أَوْ عَجْزٍ سَلِمًا مِّنَ الْإِثْمِ He says, Abdullah al-Fawzan says, if he leaves it because he's scared of a creation, or he's shy, or he's showing off, or he's unable to do it, he tried his best but he's unable to do it, سَلِمًا مِّنَ الْإِثْمِ He's safe from sin. He's safe from what? Sin. So no sin is going to be written for him. لِأَنَّهُ Why? لِأَنَّهُ لَمْ يَرْتَكِبِ حَرَامًا Because he has not done a haram. وَلَكِنْ لَا أَجْرَ لَهُ But he doesn't have a reward. No sin on him, but he also doesn't have a reward. لِأَنَّهُ لَمْ يَقْصِدْ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ بِتَرْكٍ لِلْحَرَامِ Because he did not intend the face of Allah by leaving this haram. That speech of the Shaykh, فِيهِ نَظَر There's a look to it. That's not the case. Remember we were talking about our sharh in a kitab عمدة الأحكام للإمام الحافظ عبد الغني عبد الواحد المقدسي شرح من كتاب حديث عمر بن الخطاب إنما الأعمال بالنيات We said that the turuk leaving something off are four types We said that if the person leaves it because hadith nafs First of all, something comes to his mind Are you with me? A whisper comes to his head A little waswas A whisper And that whisper it comes and it leaves It comes and he leaves. And he just goes. That individual, he will get no sin on him. You all with me? As long as he doesn't speak it or as long as he does not implement it. And that the evidence for that one is the hadith of the Messenger of Allah where he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَجَاوَزَ عَنْ أُمَّتِي مَا حَدَّثَتْ بِهَا نَفْسَهَا مَا لَمْ تَعْمَلْ أَوْ تَتَكَلَّمْ Allah has forgiven my nation for that which Allah has forgiven my nation and ummati ma hadathat biha nafsaha. That which your nafs talks to you about. Your nafs comes to you and says to you, do this. But it's that moment of whisper. Allah says, I have forgiven my creation as long as he does not implement it or what? He doesn't speak it. The second one is, so that person has nothing on him. The second is azima. He has the decision to do it. He wants to do it. He's up to do it. He wishes to do it. He tried all means to do it. He went out of his way to do it. But you know what? He wasn't able to do it. So he didn't do it. He just leaves it then. He wants to go and do zina. It's a strike, bus strikes. So there's no bus out there. How am I going to get there? You know what? Forget it. Some other time. So at that point, did he leave it off? Na'am. Was there azima lakin? Was that the conviction that he wanted to do it? Yeah. He gets a sin for it. He gets a sin for it. And that is the evidence for this. The hadith is the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا الْتَقَى الْمُسْلِمَانِ بِسَيْفَيْهِمَا فَالْقَاتِلُ وَالْمَقْتُولُ فِي النَّارِ The third one is, which is the hadith of Bakra, Abu Bakr Nufay ibn Harith al-Thaqafi, where the Messenger ﷺ said, إِذَا الْتَقَى الْمُسْلِمَانِ بِسَيْفَيْهِمَا If two groups of Muslims meet one another, فَالْقَاتِلُ وَالْمَقْتُولُ فِي النَّارِ The one that's killing and the one that's killed are both in the hellfire. Why are they both in the hellfire? The Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, هَذَا الْقَاتِلُ That's the killer. We know the killer. He's going to be in the hellfire. It makes sense. فَمَبَالُ الْمَقْتُولُ Why the one that's being killed? Why him? He said, لِأَنَّهُ كَانَ حَرِيصًا عَلَى قَتْلِ صَاحِبِهِ He also wanted to kill him. He was out there to strike him. He had the conviction. He wanted to. But the reason he never got it through is because he wasn't as talented as the killer. The fourth one is, Are you all with me? The third one is somebody who the thing came to his mind. It whispered to him. It brought thoughts to his mind. But he remembered the power of Allah. He remembered the strength and the ability of Allah. He remembered that which Allah can do, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so what did he do? He left it for Allah's sake, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That person gets rewarded for it. He gets a reward for it, let alone... So that person gets a reward for it. The fourth one is, مَنْ لَمْ يَقْعَ عَلَى الْبَالِ. Somebody, لَمْ تَقْعَ عَلَى بَالِ. Somebody who the issue has never even come to his mind. He's never thought of this wrong. Has he left it? He left it. But it never came to his mind to commit that zina. It did not even come to his mind. That person, we will say, سَلِيمًا مِنَ الْإِثْمِ. He is safe from sins. وَلَا أَجْرَ لَهُ. And he has no ajr because he didn't leave for the sake of Allah. Are you with me? So if the Shaykh rahimahullah, his speech, if he broke it up down like that, it would have been much better. It would have been much better if he put it into those categories. And we will stop there, inshallah. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.